Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. I am Karenina and this space is about mindful living, general well-being and hearty food. In today's video I'm going to share with you 10 things that we do as a family to stay connected. So if you're interested, keep watching. Number one, we encourage playtime, especially board game playtime with the family. There is a saying that says, families that play together, stay together. And this is something that I have done with my family growing up, and it's certainly something that I'm still really looking forward to every time I go to visit. And believe that it was through those bonding moments and times that we played together that it made our relationship grow stronger. Playtime creates a space for families to connect, talk and understand, as well as identify what emotional stage the children are at, and with this find what support they actually need. It could be from helping them to handle frustration to release their anger in a safe and controlled way. They can learn to self-regulate and understand that every choice has a consequence. It also teaches them that things are not always fair, not easy, but they are always just. Which nowadays is very important for children to understand that they have to work for that which they want, rather than just expecting things to happen without putting the effort into them. Number two, we try to incorporate daily exercise. It can be from going for a long walk to going to run together, or perhaps for a bike ride. This not only increases their fitness level, it also helps us to release some of that stored energy they build up throughout the day, which in turn helps us engage in a more calm way with them. Some benefits of daily exercise in children is that it provides a way to socialize. It improves their self-esteem as well as encourages healthy growth and development. Number three, we read to them and with them. I want to encourage reading in our children every day because it's not only a great source of knowledge for them, it's also a great way for them to connect with their siblings and us as parents every time they have this special time during the day. Also, when children read, this improves their concentration level and they learn a basic skill of just sitting still and listening for long periods of time, which sometimes we struggle because our little ones can be quite fidgety. They start moving here, moving there, and start getting impatient. So it's just getting into the habit that once someone is reading, they just sit and listen. And when they are reading, they are being listened to. Number four, we snuggle up more, either at bedtime or once we are sitting watching TV. It's just something that I know can really have a positive impact in their development. It can be from just stroking the hair to giving them a nice hug to just laying with them at bedtime. It's also known that children develop better when they have a parent-child attachment. It just encourages this connection that we can create as a family. Number five, we have movie nights at home. Ever since lockdown, we have tried to incorporate on a weekly basis, and it's just something that creates that bond that we all know that we are having that moment in time, enjoying the same film and experiencing different emotions. And we can talk at the end of the film about how it affected them, what they thought of the film. And it's just a moment that we really enjoy. And it also teaches our children delayed gratification, because we all tend to choose a film. We tend to flip it to see which is the film that we're going to watch the week. And sometimes it's frustrating that it's not their film, because it's five of us, so we can only watch one film every weekend. So it just shows them that despite them not having had their film that week, there will always be a chance to get a film next week. And even if they are the last ones to get the film chosen, they are more calm now. They know that the time will come and that we will respect the film that they have decided to watch, just because it's what we do with all the family. This makes them feel safe, careful, and respected. Number six, we encourage outdoor play. We enjoy things like football and frisbee, so we always make sure that we have some time outside or as a family enjoying the fresh air. Plus, this gets us out and about doing things that are good for mental and physical health. Not to mention, teaches our children how to stay safe outdoors. Number seven, we sit and eat together at meal times. Some benefits of doing this is that they develop healthier eating habits, learn to find the limits when it comes to food, and then know when to stop. Teaches them social skills, table manners, as well as it's easier for us to spot when something is not right with them. And that way we can just take them aside and then talk to them, which is something that we wouldn't be able to do if we didn't just stop for a moment, all of us, and sit together to find out how's the day been for every one of the members of the family. Number 8, we go out and enjoy nature together. This is not only something that we really enjoy doing, it's also something that we are trying to encourage our children to care for, to understand that we all live in this bigger community and have this common purpose, which is to protect our planet and the resources that we have available. It is well known that during our walks, we will encourage all children to collect litter, with the use of grabbers, of course, to try to encourage them to care more about their environment and their community, and to understand that perhaps if someone didn't decide to put that in the bin, it doesn't necessarily have to be left for someone else to do it, and then pass on that responsibility to someone else, and at the end, no one will do anything about it. It's all about us making that choice and taking that responsibility of just doing something that we know is right. It's not going to jeopardize our health in any way if we do it the right way. But it's also something that is going to help them feel that they have contributed to this community for a greater good. And of course, we teach them with example. So me and my husband will often be the ones that start collecting it. And then our little ones will just go pointing out where the rubbish is. And then they will start wanting to do it themselves. So it's not about taking them and pointing here, this is what you should be collecting, just because. You're just trying to teach them by example of why is it that we're deciding to do it, even though it wasn't our rubbish to begin with. Number 9, because not everything is serious in life, we do enjoy every now and then as a family PlayStation games that are just full of fun, make our children giggle, and it just makes a space where we can all be together again and bonding in a different way, creating this space for them to feel safe, to feel encouraged, supported, and respected regardless of what the outcome of the game is. And also, it can help them to self-regulate their emotions, because quite often things get quite heated. They get quite angry because they didn't win a game, or they get frustrated because someone else won and they didn't. And it's just part of life. You win sometimes, you lose others, and it's just about learning how to stand up and dust yourself off and keep going. And number 10, every once in a while, we just give one-to-one to each of our children. We have 3 children, and it can be hectic. It's one parent to 3 children at a time, either because I am working or my husband is working, or just because how life is. That sometimes it can feel a bit overwhelming. So oftentimes our children will come and they will just approach us and say, oh, I want to spend some time with you, or can I go to the shop with you? And they just request this for them on their own. And it's just a little moment when they have that time just to be themselves without siblings for a little bit of time. And it's just encourage individuality, which is a good thing. I mean, we are not always able to provide one-to-one attention just because of how life is. But when we can, and when they request that, we do try to make our best effort to try and provide that time that they actually need. There's a really good book that I read called The 5 Love Languages in Children. And this book is by Gary Chapman and Ross Campbell. I used to think, well, we are the same parents to all 3 children, teach them the same values, treat them the same. We all live in the same house, so surely they cannot be as different. But it's only until I've read this book that I realized, despite all that, yes, we are all different, and we all find incentive in different ways, and we all get told I love you by doing different things. For example, some people might feel loved because their loved one or someone that is with them care to make them a cup of tea or perhaps they wrote a letter to them, or maybe they invited them to go to a concert, just things like that. There are different ways in which you can show that you love. The same way, there are different ways in which children and adults can feel loved. And it's only until you try to dig in into what are those five ways, or the five main ways that this author is highlighting the book, that you actually try to start understanding how different each of your children is. Now, if you give yourself time to listen and try to find the individuality of each of your children, then you'll find out that they can be very similar but also very different at the same time. Sometimes not only one of those love languages will apply, sometimes two or more, whilst another one will really resonate with another child in particular. So if you give yourself the time to listen and be present with your child, it will help you identify what is the thing that shouts love the most to them. Overall, us as parents, we just want to create an atmosphere where we know our children will not only do well, but they will thrive, as well as give them the tools to overcome difficulties later in life, and a strong foundation which will make them more resilient and strong when the challenging times come. A few moments spent well with love and presence are much better than every single minute of your day devoted to them. If you are absent, if you're not present, and if your mind is away in something else. So if you find that you're rushing, that you don't really have much time to give to them, just 5 minutes of undivided attention where you are there and you're present and you're listening and really trying to find out what's going on with them, it will make quite a big difference. I really hope that you find these 10 tips helpful and that you like this video. And if you did, please consider subscribing and giving me a thumbs up. And I look forward to seeing you until my next video. My name is Karenina. Stay strong, healthy, and happy.